So writing this book, Injustice, the story of the Holy Land Foundation 5, was much more complicated and much more difficult project than I ever imagined it to be. Putting together the narratives of five men who are today in federal prison, putting together the story of the actual organization that they ran and which was declared a terrorist organization or supporter of terrorist organization, and then giving everything context, why it was formed, when it was formed, was really a great deal more work than I ever imagined it to be, and I'm really glad that it came together. Thanks to Just World Books and thanks to great editors that helped me out, I was able to put together a narrative, a coherent story. And it's a story that I think most people would not believe. Most people, if you spoke to somebody in a cafe or on the street and told them the story, told them what happened here in the United States to these five men, most people would shake their head in disbelief. Which again is why I thought it was so important to tell the story, to write this book, because as I was learning about the story and sharing it with other people, that was the response that I got. That's impossible, that cannot be, this cannot be happening in the United States. And I think it goes back to several things. First of all, there has been a very clear campaign to conflate anything that's Palestinian with terrorism. And charity to Palestine and Palestinian charities have been the last link on this chain. So Palestinian culture is being deemed and called terrorist. Palestinian poetry, poets, Palestinian writers, Palestinian art is considered terrorism. When children's art exhibit was going around the U.S., you know, there were places that there were demands to close it down because it was terrorism and so forth. And of course, Palestinian resistance is terrorism. Palestinian resistance, whether it's armed or unarmed, is terrorism. And Palestinian charity has been linked to terrorism as well, which is why, and it was really the last bastion, if you will. And so they had to be taken down. The Holy Land Foundation, which was the largest Muslim charity in America and a highly respected charity, which did a lot of wonderful things around the world, including here in the United States, like responding to Oklahoma City bombing and responding to floods and responding to disasters around the US and around the world, but particularly focusing on Palestine and run by Palestinians, had to be taken down because it gave legitimacy to something that was Palestinian. It gave legitimacy to an aspect of the Palestinian narrative. And I believe that's why it had to be taken down, and that's why it was taken down. And the idea that you can conflate charity with terrorism requires a little thinking. How do you put that together? So the implication was, or the claim was, that by giving charity to Palestinians, this the Holy Land Foundation allowed Hamas, which was declared a terrorist organization here in the United States in 1995, had more funds with which to commit acts of terrorism. That was one claim. Another claim was that by helping orphans, the charity was encouraging the fathers of children to go and blow themselves up and commit acts of terrorism. And the third aspect was that by supporting the families of Palestinian prisoners, once again, Palestinians would know or get a sense that their families were going to be taken care of, so why not engage in terrorism, and therefore now they're in prison, so we cannot support their families because that would be supporting terrorism as well. And and one of the things I did in this book, rather than argue this myself, is I put a lot of information directly from the transcripts of the trial so that the reader can tell what the arguments were on both sides and make the judgment for themselves. On the issue of the orphans, for example, it was made abundantly clear that very few, if any, of the orphans that the Holy Land Foundation was supporting were connected in any way, shape, or form to any acts of terrorism. Fathers died for all sorts of different reasons, natural causes, you name it, lots of different causes. And very little, if any, connection was made between the deaths or the reasons these children became orphans and terrorism. Another thing that I brought in that I was able to look at is the profile of actual Palestinian suicide bombers in the years that they were the suicide bombings were taking place, and none of them had children. So whichever way you looked at it, the orphans had nothing to do with this, with any of this. But this had no made no difference in terms of these men's convictions, and they were all convicted. According to Israeli sources, the vast majority of Palestinians who are in Israeli jails have not been engaged in acts of violence, so they're not terrorists. They're political prisoners. But again, the story was, the claim was that they are terrorists, and that's what that's what the jury chose to believe. And there were other aspects of the trial that were so outrageous that and so egregious that I purposefully added so the reader can actually see what took place in the trial and what enormous injustice was done to these people. Now, besides all of that, there's the story of the Arab and Muslim, and particularly the Palestinian community here in America. The story of five men who were good men who came to America to study and then stayed here, like many immigrants, and basically became part of middle-class America. And then decided to give back, created and worked with the Holy Land Foundation in order to help. And then again, for no fault of their own, were brought down by the U.S. government. let's see, what else? So there's then there's a story that the terrible misconceptions that exist here in the United States about Palestinian resistance, about Hamas particularly, and generally about Islam and what Islam is and what the Muslim Brotherhood is as an organization. So I took some time and some space in the book to talk about those things as well, again trying to create context, and then trying to create context of the reality in Palestine. An interesting thing that was brought up in the trial was that the Holy Land Foundation was founded the same year as Hamas was founded. But those were not the only two things that happened that year. The Holy Land Foundation was the Palestinian Intifada, the first Palestinian uprising, also began in that year. And so the need for a great need for charity arose in Palestine, and that's what drove these men to do this. And there are other different reasons, other different things that happened, which drove these guys to create this organization, to work for charity for Palestinians. So it's really obvious how the prosecution tried to cherry pick certain aspects of the story and create this and prosecute these guys. The sad thing is that they have been that they were convicted, that they are now sitting in federal prison. Two men are in prison for 65 years. Shukri Abu Bakr and Ghassan Elashi. One is sitting in for 20 years, Mufid Abdul Qadir, and two for 15 years, Abdul Rahman Ode and Muhammad Al-Mzain. I visited all but one. For some reason, Ghassan Elashi, I was not able to visit. The prison authorities didn't permit me to visit him. And to see good, innocent men in this horrendous, horrendous system, which is the prison system in the United States, the Bureau of Prisons, is a tragedy all on its own. And that's another aspect of the story that I put in the book, which is what it's like in the prisons, what it's like to visit a prisoner, what it's like for the families, the process of being approved, the process of visiting, the process of leaving, sitting in a room full of prisoners, and you're facing a human being who has done nothing wrong and is really should not even be there. And then looking at the families that go in and out, and the hundreds and thousands and millions of Americans who go through this every single day, every single week, all over the U.S. is another part of the story, and it's something that I chose to share with the readers. So like I said, this book demanded that I put together lots and lots of different aspects that make up the story, and I'm very grateful. Thankfully, we were able to put it all together into this book. The name Injustice, I think, is speaks for itself. And the story of the Hoyland Foundation 5 is a story that should be read and told and talked about. And my hope is that there would be a demand to reopen the case and exonerate.